Good morning. I want to welcome you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us rejoice because we have gathered together by Zoom and by YouTube later on today to, as a community in person and virtually, to proclaim our risen Lord Jesus Christ. So I definitely want to welcome each and every one of you today. Today is Communion Sunday, and so for those of us who are gathered here together, we will join together in community in communion, as well as those on Zoom and YouTube. Those on Zoom and YouTube, make sure you have bread and juice ready, and take it as I'm directed here. Again, at that proper time, come through the inner aisle, get your cup. If you want, one person can gather for their family, and then go back to your seats to the side aisle so we have that flow. That'd be fantastic. But then again, we are a community of faith gathered together, so I want to welcome each and every one of you. I know we have an announcement today, so we'll first go with Debbie Bender.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
As you saw in the Revelations, deacons are getting ready for another project. And we know, and I'm actually going to address the ladies because it's spring cleaning. Men might spring clean, but it's like hard to get them to do it. So,
Debbie, I've got to tell you, thank you so much. I really appreciate you saying that because I'm going to go to Nancy and say, I was loud off the hook. It's not my job. Debbie Bender said so. Thank you.
However, if men want to clean, we still could use theirs as well. The deacons will be collecting shoes, slightly used shoes that are in good condition, or new shoes that ladies tend to buy, and then you can't wear them. So we are going to let you know in the future, because we're still in the planning stages of Souls for Souls, and we will let you know what Souls for Souls do. But when you start cleaning, put aside those shoes. Men, women, and children, athletic and shoes of all types. Thank you.
Thank you, Debbie. And Don?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Even though it's going up to 70 degrees today, we still have plenty of soup from the reach out group. Many thanks to the many people who cut up the vegetables, the meat, and spent time making soup for us. We have about 11 varieties, so we ask that you line up at the first table to pick up your first free quart of soup for household, and then come around the corner if you wish to purchase any more for a small fee. And we have also chocolate-covered Oreos for you to try today as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Don. Any other announcements? Not seeing any. Then what are our prayer concerns or joys and concerns for prayer today? We're continuing to keep the situation of the Ukraine in our prayers. I know there are folks that are having some back problems. We keep them in our prayers. Susie Dempsey's mother-in-law, Anne Marie, having some difficulty. We'll keep her in our prayers. Any others? I see Doreen.
My friend Isabella from the.
We did not hear that.
My friend is Isabella from Lifespan is in hospice. Pray for her family.
Your friend is in hospice, and her name is Isabel, right? Doreen Legg's friend, Isabel, in hospice. Okay. Any others? Yes, John. Wait for the microphone.
My daughter-in-law's dad, John Gaber.
John Caper? Gaber. Is this Susie's?
No, it is Gene, my brother Andy's father-in-law.
Oh, your brother Andy's father-in-law, okay. Okay, okay. Andy's father-in-law, okay, got it. So Andy Federkow's father-in-law passed away. Any others? Then let us center ourselves on the worship of God.
Let us join together in our responsive call to worship. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose.
For those who before knew,
he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Let us worship God.
So this morning we're going to do Good, Good Father. I'm still recovering with my voice. I appreciate it if you all sing out very strong and loudly. And really, if it's, you know, it's just basically opening your heart to worshiping. So even if you wanted to sit and just reflect on the song, that kind of thing, but just make sure that you're opening your heart and getting ready for worship this morning with the song.
Ooh, I heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never for answers far and wide, but I know as you call me, deeper still as you call.
To prepare for worship. Amen.
Let us go to God in unison, ask for his mercy and grace. O God of resurrection glory, we celebrate the reality that the day is coming that we will see your Son coming on the cloud, and with the trumpet sound, the dead will rise, and then the living to be with you for all eternity with our new resurrection bodies. However, so often we do not live into this reality, but act as if the pleasures of the here and now are more important. Forgive us and lead us through your Holy Spirit to live as if we are already in the new heaven and the new earth.
In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Christian friends, so often we don't live into the reality of what God in Christ has promised us, but we live in the here and now, bowing to our own pleasures and wants and desires. But the good news is that we have the power, the companionship of the Holy Spirit to do just that, to live not in the here and now, but to live in the then, as if we are already standing before the presence of God. So hear the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Let's remain standing and affirm what we believe by sharing together the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. The third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father, and he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated.
You can sit.
He is Lord, He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus.
Let us pray that God will open our hearts and our minds. We come to you in the knowledge that we will hear the truth. Open our minds to seek the word and to share what we learn with those around us. Help us in our confusion to seek clarity and enable us to set our preconceptions aside to hear and understand the truth of Christ, which will set us free. We ask this all in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our first reading comes from the Apostle Paul's first letter to the church in Thessalonica, chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself would descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. May the Lord bless this reading and the understanding of his most holy word.
So as we said, we're praying for Ukraine and for, you know, everything that they're going through right now. This has really touched me lately in the news and has really affected me. I've been watching some of the videos, and I wanted to show you just a couple here that I've seen. Maybe you've seen them as well, of people that are coming together and singing as part of their getting through some of this. So I want to show you just these two videos that a group of people in the subway, and you know how people have reacted to them. The second one was students that were singing in the dark, and it just reminded me of this song again. What they were singing was Mighty to Save, and I just thought that was so beautiful that, you know, we're all praying for the same thing, and we're connected in the Christianity, and being able to, you know, the power of that, of just imagining them huddled together and singing this beautiful song of hope. So that's what I wanted us to focus on this morning, is mighty to save. And just kind of keeping them in our prayers as we think through this song. I do feel like we're so fortunate of where we're at, and it's just hard to imagine what they're going through of you know, separating families. And I know they said there were at least 500,000 kids that have gotten out of their, you know, families separating. It just seems crazy in today's day and age that this is going on. So I just really want to keep them in our prayers and really kind of reflect on this with Mighty to Save.
Our scripture today comes from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15, verses 12 to 24. It's important that we understand the context. Paul has written a long letter to the church in Corinth about their divisions, about their problems. And now he's talking about, he says, I want you to know about the resurrection, just to be clear. Jesus did rise from the dead. He appeared to John and to Cephas, Simon Peter. He appeared to 500 other people. Most of them are still alive. A few of them are asleep, meaning dead, but most of them are still alive. So understand there is a reality that this happened, and there's evidence this happened, and there are people you can talk to say, yes, this happened. So now he speaks about it in a little more detail in verses, chapter 15, verses 12 through 24. Because apparently some people aren't getting it. So hear these words. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. We're even found to be misrepresenting God because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope, in this life only we are all people must be pitied. We have all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead and the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, then as his, at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father after destroying every rule and every authority and power. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So the question we all need to ask, especially Sylvia, will you have to shave your resurrected body? Now, that's akin to the idea of how many angels can dance on the head of a pin. Or is there a boulder so, if God can do anything, can he create a boulder so large he can't lift it? So these are somewhat silly questions to ask. But our sermon thought today tells us that God in Christ has promised us a resurrection body. So we will understand that we will be, so that we will understand that we will be glorified heart, mind, body, and soul in order that no trace of sin can be found in us. So that is what we are called to understand, and that's how we are called to live. But when we first think about the body, what do we think about the body? Now, the big term nowadays is body positivity. Now, some people might not have a lot of body positivity when they stand on the scales after eating a big Chinese dinner where all that salt has gathered all the fluid, and therefore their weight might not be quite what they deemed it they wanted it to be. Or after they eat five pieces of cheesecake, or after they don't do anything for a long time, they might find their body positivity might be a little messed up. And some people might think, this is what I want to be, but this is who I am, and how do I get there? And if it's not possible, then they again might have a sense of negative body positivity or body shame. Now, we all know that people can be very self-critical. I'm too skinny. I want to be skinny. I'm too fat. I hate my pick a part of your body, and that criticism, that negativity can really bring you down. Now, body positivity, say our differences make us beautiful, embrace your unique qualities, and love who you are. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. It's even worse when there's other people that want to tell you about how your body should be. You know, you are too fat. I don't approve of the outfit you're wearing. What are you thinking when you eat that sandwich? Lose some weight, you're too skinny, you're too fat, whatever. Some would call that body shaming. And we certainly should not do that. We certainly should not do that. So let's be clear about that. Because everybody is beautiful, both inside and out. And we need to see that beauty about who each and every one of us are. Now, that doesn't take away if you feel you need to lose weight. Fine. If you need to gain weight, fine. That's your own deal. We should not be body shaming each other. We should be embracing each other. That's what we should be doing. But how does this all come to focus on the creed, the Apostles' Creed? I believe in the resurrection of the body. Well, that's important because sometimes we sort of like kick the body aside, the physical body, that the day is coming when we'll just be spirit. Look forward to that day because we can release all of what this is and embrace what all we envision that spirit to be. Now, when we think about that, we think about Jesus Christ, the resurrection of Christ. He is not here, for he is risen. We believe that, don't we? In fact, don't we need to believe that? Because it says in Romans chapter 10, if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is the Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. This is what we are called to believe. So if you do not believe Jesus is the Lord, and if you do not believe that God raised him from the dead, then if we make the conclusion, you are not saved. So we can all agree that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead. I was going to say, raise your hand if you don't agree with that. Well, don't, because I come to me later and we'll talk. But to be a Christian, to be a follower of Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ is Lord, God raised him from the dead. Those are two essentials that you can't walk away from. So we agree with them, agree with that. The but is it physical? Is it spiritual? Is there a difference between the two? Did Jesus raise physically or did Jesus raise spiritually? Well, we have to understand what Scripture says. Scripture is clear that it is mind, body, and spirit, that there's a unity of who we are, and they did not see it back in the day, a difference. Modern times see a difference. There's especially in a New Age concept of what we think of ourselves. There's spirit, which is good, and there's body, which is bad. The early Christians and the Hebrews or the Jews would never have thought of that. Mind, body, and spirit are so intertwined you cannot separate them. So therefore you cannot separate the physical body from the spiritual body. And what that means for us in our understanding of the resurrection of the dead. Now that should blow our minds. That really should. We should say, okay, if that's not the case, then how do we explain what we say we know? And, you know, I was talking with Nancy, my wife, yesterday, and asked her, when people ask the questions, why are we talking about this, especially when it's something they disagree with or something they don't understand, says, don't we just believe Jesus is Jesus? Well, it's a depth of faith that we have to have in order to, with integrity, share our faith with people that have questions. Because I'll guarantee you people out there will have questions. And if we at least don't have some idea of what we're talking about, or at least a presence of mind to say, I don't understand, but I'll find out, then we can create a barrier for them to come to faith when they may be looking for that very thing. So we understand that it's heart, mind, body, and soul. We're all united. It's a unity of who we are, the unity of the body. Now, on the other hand, we have to ask ourselves a different set of questions. What will we look like? What will we look like in heaven? Is it just, this is what I got, and this is all I got? So in heaven, I'm going to be walking around like this, and people are going, hey, Bob, how you doing? You lost a little weight? No, you haven't, because it's your resurrected body. It's who you are. Is that what the deal is going to be? And that is a legitimate question. But we look at what happened to Jesus. Now, when Jesus was raised from the dead, did he have a physical body? He ate. He drank. He walked. He did seem to be able to go from one place to another pretty quickly. He did seem to go through doors pretty quickly. But still, when people touched him, they did not touch spirit. They did not touch Casper, the friendly ghost. They touched flesh. And so the answer would be, in heaven, will we have physical bodies? It would seem so. But again, how is our resurrection body going to be different from our current body? That's another legitimate question. How we look, what's the difference going to be? If the answer is yes, we have physical bodies, okay. But we still need to say what Scripture says and what Scripture doesn't say. I like this understanding that when we think about the resurrection to come, we think about what we know as rapture. I love the song, Stand Up for Jesus. It talks about the trumpet call, obey, forth to his mighty conflict, and this is glorious day. It's talking about when Jesus comes on the cloud. We read about that in our Thessalonians passage, that the day is coming when Jesus will come on a cloud and things are going to happen. There's going to be a trumpet sound, and then we're going to start rising to meet Jesus in the clouds. Okay, that looks good. Next slide. Let's go back to the Thessalonians passage and see what it really does say. According to the Lord's word, this is God's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. Now, these aren't people taking naps. I told you earlier, the concept of falling asleep is the concept of dying. So those who have died and believe those who are alive will not precede those who have fallen asleep, those who have died. Okay, that's important to understand. Now, some would say death for a Christian is to fall asleep in the arms of Jesus and wake it up and find out that you're home. I remember it can be very tricky to understand the chronology of this. Don't focus on the chronology because our time is in God's time. God's time is in our time. We have to understand God has a purpose and plan, so the today for us might be the future, the present, the past for God. We don't understand that. But we do understand those who die fall asleep, and when we come to consciousness, we are with the Lord. So however that works, that's the way it works. But isn't that a comfort to know that when we die, when we wake up, if we die in the arms of Christ, when we wake up, we'll be with the Lord. But it goes on for 1 Thessalonians, said, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Now, this is like, listen up, everyone. I want to make sure you hear this. No one's going to miss this. And Paul makes clear, no one's going to go, well, I was physically asleep. I was taking a nap. Or I was preoccupied. The trumpet will shout it. Everyone will hear it. And then we know things will start happening. Christ will come down, and now the dead will rise. It's like a queue up. You know, the dead will go up first. Now, I don't know if that's an orderly fashion, but we do know the dead will rise. God is a God of order, not chaos. So however it works, the dead will rise. But by all accounts, they will rise in their physical body. Not in a spiritual sense, but in a physical sense. And after that, we who are still left and who are alive and are left will be caught up. That word caught up is where you get the whole word rapture. It's French, together with them in the cloud to meet the Lord in the air. So, first the dead, then the living. And again, we're not said that suddenly our spirits leave us and our bodies are left here. We will rise up. We will ascend into heaven. Great. And that's what the rapture is about. There's no great mystery or, this is weird. I mean, it is a little strange, but this is what it's supposed to mean, because now Christ has come. And then we understand at that point we have judgment. Okay, great. So But we also know that where two or more gathered together in my name, I am in the midst of them. So until that day happens, we live in the reality that that day will happen, but we live together as brothers and sisters in anticipation that whether we're asleep, whether we're alive, the day will come when we will be with the Lord. Great. Now, 1 Corinthians goes on to say, but God gives it a body. He's talking about our physical body now. But God gives it a body. As he has determined into each kind of seed, he gives his own body. All flesh is not the same. Men have one kind of flesh. Animals have another. Birds another. Fish another. So God is going to place the seed in our body, in our human body now, is going to grow into our resurrection body through the power of the Holy Spirit. And just as now, then, God has strategically designed each of us where he can most effectively use us. God is using us as his people in ways here, just as God will use us as his people when we ascend into heaven. And our physical selves, as well as our spiritual selves, remember, united, will be all a part of that design. Not how we might see it, but strictly how God does see it. And that's what we need to have a mindset about, what it means to have a resurrected body. This is not to serve us, so we really should not be concerned about what we're going to look like. We shouldn't really be concerned about how the difference, our difference between our current body and our resurrected body. Our focus should be that our body today, right now, here, is designed heart, mind, body, and soul to serve the Lord. And when we are resurrected, our body, as we ascend to the clouds, will be designed heart, mind, body, and soul to serve the Lord in that capacity. That is what we should be about. But the question still exists. Did Jesus truly rise from the dead? Why do people question that? Even Christians still question that. They would say, oh, I'm a Christian because I like to follow what Jesus said, but let's forget all the little nonsense about actually being resurrected. There's no such thing as resurrection. There are Christians today who believe that, just like there were early Christians who believed that. The Jews did not believe that as a whole. The Jews today don't believe that. They don't believe in the resurrection. There are some small groups who do, but by and large, Judaism as a whole does not believe in the resurrection of the dead. So this was a big difference in Christianity, to move from that concept to the new concept of belief that Jesus did truly rise, heart, body, mind, and soul from the dead. And that we will too. So when we hear that I believe in the resurrection of the dead, we are not just focused on Jesus, we are focused on ourselves and all Christians. So Paul continues now in 1 Corinthians, the question, he's using a very logical sequence of questions to ask each one of us, if you don't believe that, this is what it means. He says, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. It's like Ecclesiastes, meaninglessness, meaninglessness, all is meaningless. If you don't get what God is trying to do for us and in us, then all this is just a bunch of nonsense. If Jesus did not rise from the dead, then what's the point? And if there's no point in Jesus because Jesus didn't rise from the dead, what is the point of our own faith? We are pretending that there is any significance in what we believe because it centers around the uniqueness of what God and Christ did in Jesus to raise him from the dead. Now, he says, we've been found false witnesses of God because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up. I love the King James. For whom he raised not up, if so be it that the dead don't rise. Basically saying, there are seen people out there that are saying that Jesus didn't rise from the dead. These are false witnesses. It's like fake news. You know, we read something on the news and we go, oh, yeah, that happened. But then we find out later, oops, it didn't. And that's usually in sort of like small little, oh, by the way, this thing that we said happened, didn't happen. We hear about the Ukraine, the 12 Ukrainian soldiers on the island, the whatever, Snake Island or whatever, that were killed when they said, you know, in a very non-friendly way to the Russian warship, we're not leaving. Didn't happen. Russian government says, oh, yeah, that didn't happen. But we all go, boy, wow, look at those 12 soldiers. Well, yeah, sure, that's easy when it doesn't happen. And just back then, these things happened, and there are those who say, no, it didn't. Jesus didn't rise from the dead because there's always been false prophets, false apostles, false teachers, false Christs, false deceivers. There's always been someone out there that said, nah, this didn't happen, or this happened when it actually didn't. The question is, we have to be alert to that, and how can we be alert to that unless we know what Scripture says, and unless we believe what Scripture says, and unless we have the power of the Holy Spirit that gives us the faith to understand what Scripture says. Because he goes, if the dead was not raised, not even Christ was raised, and if Christ was not raised, our faith is worthless. So we are still in our sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ, those who say, I believe, and they fall asleep, if we had hoped in Christ in this life only, we are of all men most to be pitied. Those who have fallen asleep in Christ, if this isn't true, they've perished. And we're going to perish. If faith is vain because we don't want to believe what Scripture says, then it's not real faith. Faith is when we do believe what Scripture says, and we do have the power of the Holy Spirit to give us the understanding this is truth. And this is where we're going to stand, even if there are those, the false prophets, false teachers, or whoever, that say, no, this isn't. Because I don't know about you, but I don't want to be pitied. And I stand by what Scripture says, regardless. But if we actually believe that Jesus did not rise from the dead, that means, and because we don't rise from the dead, heart, mind, body, and soul, that our faith is in vain, and we are truly to be pitied. And we understand that he was raised because he is the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. We see that in the book of Romans, that whole concept. That Adam is the head guy that brings sin into the world, as Christ is the head guy that brings salvation into the world. Here, Adam came into the world and through his sin brings death. Jesus brings life. Adam brings eternity in Sheol and hell and Hades. We talked about that. Jesus Christ brings resurrection. So we are made alive with Christ and in Christ. And not in pretense, but in reality. So we are dead to sin, but we are alive to God. And that is where we take great comfort and great certainty that this is not about us getting what we want. This is what God has already enacted to proclaim and to extend his kingdom into the world. But of each one in his own order, Christ the first fruit, afterwards those who are Christ at his coming, then comes in when he's delivered the kingdom to God the Father, when he puts an end to all rule and all authority and all power. Now the rule, the authority, and power is solely in Jesus. He comes with that resurrection power as the first fruits to our own resurrection. Because Jesus was raised, we now can be raised. And that shows us how much God loves us. That he is not leaving us to our own misery and death, but he has lifted us to resurrection life and resurrection bodies to be glorified for his purpose, his plan, and to be united in heaven as we are united here on earth. Because we all believe that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and God raised him from the dead. And so we are part of the great harvest. We are part of the harvest, just as we become sowers and reapers in the harvest. So we're not supposed to grow weary in doing good, for at the time, the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we just do not give up. As I said, we have been harvested for Christ, and we now harvest the growing field of disciples out there for Christ. We do it because this is what Christ has called us to do. Because all authority in heaven and earth has been given to him, so we obey him. Just as we believe in him and what he's done for us. So we look forward to the Lord Jesus Christ coming from heaven as our Savior. Not as, oh Lord, come Lord Jesus, when and where. Yes, we say come Lord Jesus, when and where, because we expect it. And until now, from now until then, we live it. We live in that reality. That we are going to have a resurrection from the dead. We will have resurrected bodies. We will be glorified before a God in heaven. And that we will be part of the kingdom. We are citizens of heaven. So we look forward to Lord Jesus Christ coming from heaven as our Savior, through his power to bring everything under his authority, and we will change our humble bodies and make them like his glorified body, because he is the first fruit. God is faithful yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And in that faithfulness, we can trust in what he promises. And that promise is that the day will come when the trumpet will sound and the heavens will part and we will rise in the resurrection body that he has intended for each one of us. And when we believe that, we become united in our faith, and this table is part of that unity of faith. For we don't just take this meal together here at Lebanon, we take this meal with Christians around the world at this time, in this place. Be that virtually or be that in person, we take this meal in the unity of that understanding. Christian friends, let us know that God is faithful. He has called us, he has proclaimed us, and God will resurrect us, because Jesus Christ was resurrected as the first fruit of our own resurrection. Let us look forward to the day, and let us live according to that now and always. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we ask your blessings to be with us as we partake of this holy meal, knowing that this is an act of unity with Christians around the world, looking forward to that wonderful day when you will return. Until then, let us take confidence in our belief that we are going to be resurrected, heart, mind, body, and soul, because your Son was resurrected, heart, mind, body, and soul. What that will look like specifically, we might not know, but what we do know, it's not going to be a partial resurrection. It's not going to be just a spiritual resurrection. It's going to be a complete resurrection according to your will and according to your purpose. We thank you in your Son's holy name. Amen. Christian friends, we're told on the night in which our Lord and Savior was betrayed, after giving thanks, he took a loaf of bread and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood for the remission of sins. For as often as you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christian friends, the table is set. God has called us to partake. Let's enjoy this wonderful meal. Christian friends, this is the body of Christ. Take and eat. This is the blood of Christ. Take and drink. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we do come to you with sadness on our hearts for all what's happening in the Ukraine. Many times we don't understand fake news from real news, but we do understand that people are dying and that there's an aggressor and people that are being aggressed upon. Lord, be with the Ukrainian government, be with its people. Let them be protected. But we also pray for the Russian government. Let they turn away from their aggression. But be with their people as they are suffering as well. Lord, we ask you to be with our country. There's so much division in our country. Be with our borders. Be with your will. For sometimes, again, we don't understand. And we can't trust what we see. Help us to know through your power, your Holy Spirit, what we are called to do. Help us to be righteous and kind to one another. But let us have the firmity of faith to know that you are with us and that we are following what you're calling us to do as opposed to anything else. Be with Donna Carney as she continues to improve with her infusions. We thank you that Dorothy Lee and Tom Fox, who have fallen, that they're doing well or better. Be with Cindy Hawk's brother, Bill, who's undergoing pancreatic cancer, testing to see if it's still in remission. If your will, let it be so. Be with Celia Saycatch's son-in-law, Dan, who has to have a cornea transplant. Be with Dan Cork's mom as she recovers from being hit by a car. With Bill Maloney and Judy Butler. Be with Lori's mother, Claire, and Joyce's sister, Cheryl, and their medical difficulties. Be with those who have back pain, such as Pearl Montgomery and Janet Federkow, and Bernie Hollis. Lord, be with Patty Wonka's sister, Linda, as she supports her husband, Tom, who again, has pancreatic cancer and who's having a lot of fear. Be with Susie Dempsey's mother-in-law, Anne Marie, who has water in her lungs. And Doreen Legg's friend, Isabel, who's in hospice. And Lord, be with the family of John Gaber, who recently passed away. And let that family know that you are with them each and every day. Lord, be with us each and every day as we center ourselves on what you call us to do, and we thank you for your love and your presence, and we thank you that you are going to resurrect our bodies into the glorified body as we stand before the throne. Until then, let's live in that moment. Let's live as if we're already there, casting aside our sins and embracing the righteousness that only comes through the power of your Holy Spirit. Until that great and glorious day, let us pray the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Christian friends, it's right and proper that God has given us so much that we return a portion to him. We have offering baskets in the back for all those who have come in, who've already laid their offerings. We thank you. For those of us here as we leave to do the same, again, it's the Lord loves a cheerful giver, as well as those on YouTube and on Zoom, if they could send their offerings in. That allows us to continue to do the ministry of outreach here at Lebanon and the West Mifflin area and throughout the world. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for these gifts, and let them be a light unto your eyes so that they can be used to glorify you above all things until that day we stand before you and you glorify us We thank you and ask this all in your son's holy name. Your son's holy name. Amen. Christian friends, we believe in the resurrection of the dead. We believe that Jesus Christ was raised heart, mind, body, and soul. We believe he is the first fruits of our own resurrection, heart, mind, body, and soul. And until that grand and glorious day when we ascend into the clouds, let's live each and every moment in that reality. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the companionship of God's Holy Spirit be upon each and every one of us now and always. Amen.